Oh, there he is. And well, I learned from this that you studied in Saraswati's secondary school in Thane. That was long back, and I didn't know that. And attended Ruparel College. Well, what I do know is that he was awarded the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award for Science and Technology. That's the highest science award in India for 2013 in physical sciences. And he mainly works in high energy physics with the focus on neutrinos and the role they play in astrophysics and cosmology. So he did his BTEC from IIT Powai and he did his PhD from Chicago. And later he was a postdoc at ICTP, CERN, Max Planck Institute in Munich before he joined TIFR as 2003 as faculty member. And he's a fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, and he has won the Shondo Jayanti Fellowship from BSU. What year was that?
Sorry.
Shondo Jayanti, what year?
2009.
Very good.
Plus minus one.
And today, both Amul and I will talk about neutrinos, but we agreed he should go first, because he will provide a broad introduction to the topic for those of you who have not encountered it earlier. And I will then talk about my involvement in an experimental ice cube, which actually directs this. How about this?
Okay. Thanks for the introduction. So as Subir said, I will give you, I'll set the stage up in a more broad sense by starting with telling about neutrinos to those who never encountered that before. And then, of course, Subir will come and talk about high energy neutrinos part. So, is there a pointer that I can use?
Yes, it's there.
Okay, wonderful. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, so this is called looking at the sky with neutrinos, and we'll come to why I say that. What you see here are cosmic ray showers that are coming down from the sky all the time, and I will talk about it at some point of time in my talk. So neutrinos, although we don't notice them, happen to be omnipresent. Sun is the largest source of neutrinos we have in the sky, and in fact so large that as we are sitting in this room, through each of our bodies, every second, we have about 100 trillion neutrinos that are passing through. Okay, that's a large number. Most of them are coming from the sun. I will talk about that in a while. Supernova, when the stars explode, they give a large amount of neutrinos, and that's something I've been working on for the last almost 20 years, so partly topic very close to my heart. I will spend some time working on that. Neutrinos can come from astrophysical accelerators like active galactic nuclei or perhaps a gamma ray burst, but that part will be again covered mainly in Subir's talk. There are neutrinos all around us, in fact also in the empty spaces between galaxies that were produced at a time of Big Bang, and just like we have cosmic microwave background radiation of photons, we also have a background field of neutrinos, about 300 neutrinos per centimeter cube. We haven't seen them yet, but I will talk about how we are trying to actually locate them. Earth's crust has uranium, thorium, potassium, radioactive elements, all of them give neutrinos. If you have eaten banana today, you would have eaten lots of neutrinos, and you are now a source of neutrinos at least for some time. These are the cosmic ray neutrinos that we saw on the first slide, but of course man-made neutrinos also there. Nuclear reactors, whenever we have nuclear reactions, we produce neutrinos, and an accelerator like CERN. At LHC that Shirup talked about in the morning, we do produce a lot of neutrinos, except that we don't observe them there. Why? Hopefully we will learn in the next two of these slides. Some essentials that you need to be aware of. They are the second most abundant, I should say, known particles in the universe, given that we are talking about dark matter too. Whereas CMB photons are about 400 per cc, CMB neutrinos are about 330 per centimeter cubed. They happen to be the lightest massive particles that we know. So we know that they are not massless, they definitely have mass. However, their mass is at least a million times lighter than the electron. Okay? We don't know exactly what it is, but we know that it's at the most about one electron volt, much less than that actually. So therefore, there has not been a direct mass measurement yet. How do we measure their mass? Perhaps 10 more slides. They happen to be the most weakly interacting particles that we know. In fact, they are a perfectly valid candidate for dark matter because they don't interact with light. So by definition, they are dark matter, except that we know that because they are not very heavy, they form a very, very small part of dark matter of the order of 1% or less. What's more important is this, and that actually qualifies neutrinos as something very interesting and very challenging to detect. If, for example, you handle radioactive sources in the lab, normally you have a radioactive source and you put some lead bricks in front, maybe this thing, and your teacher perhaps tells you that you are now safe, nothing will harm you at all. So alpha, beta and gamma rays that come from our typical radioactive source in the lab will be stopped by about 50 centimeters of lead shielding or maybe iron shielding. But as you see here, if I want to stop neutrinos from the sun, let's say I don't like this 100 trillion dyes per second through my body, I feel very unhappy about it, and I want to put some lead shielding between the sun and the earth, I actually would like lead lead with a thickness of a few light years. Clearly the distance between the sun and the earth is about 8 light minutes, so this is an impossible task. So this gives an idea of how weakly interacting neutrinos are as compared to other things that we see. The question then is, how do you detect them? So clearly, since the cross section is very, very small, we need very large detectors. This is one of the largest detectors. It's called Super Kamio Kande, which exists in Japan. It is actually made up of water. So what you see here is water. What you see here are three men in a boat, literally three men in a boat. What they are doing, they are trying to clean up these phototubes. So imagine that this detector has 50 million liters of water. I tried to do some calculations. If you try to want to build a building on top of this room, you would need about 40 storied building to make the size of the detector. Detector is really, really, really huge. Every dot that you see here is a photomultiplier tube, which is approximately this size. Okay? What happens, therefore, is when a neutrino comes, most of them just pass through without doing anything. One out of 10 to the power 23, 24 interacts. When it interacts, it gives out, let's say, an electron. Now, this electron may be traveling very fast because neutrino had a very high energy. It's a relatively thick electron. It perhaps can travel at a speed greater than the speed of light in water, and then it gives out Cherenkov radiation. This Cherenkov radiation can be observed by these photomultiplier tubes, and that tells you that we have found neutrinos. There are many ways of finding neutrinos. This happens to be one of the sort of interesting ways which is used in Super Kamio Kande. However, in spite of these many neutrinos to our body per second, and in spite of 10 to the power 25 neutrinos passing through the detector every day, only 5 to 10 are actually detected every day, and that simply is because most of them pass through undetected. So recipe for detecting neutrinos is build very large detectors and wait for a very, very long time. Usually neutrino physicists live very long. That's because unless you live very long, you cannot really be a neutrino physicist. They fit very nicely with the standard model of particle physics that Shirup told us today morning. For each of the three leptons, electron, muon, tau, there is one neutrino, electron, neutrino, muon, neutrino, tau, neutrino. They are chargeless, spin half and almost massless, as we already know. When we say electron neutrinos, what exactly do we mean? It is that particle which, when hits the nucleus, gives out electron. Okay? What we mean by a muon neutrino is when it hits something, it gives out a muon. And what we mean by tau neutrino is that when it hits a nucleus, it gives out a tau particle. And if these particles happen to be positively charged, we will call them as antineutrinos, nu e bar, nu bar and nu tau bar. Okay? So that sets up our convention, our language, and now we can talk about looking at a sky neutrino. There are two things we can do when looking at a sky neutrinos. Number one, you learn about neutrino properties by looking at what comes to you. Second is you learn from observation of neutrinos, you learn about the sky, you learn about objects in the sky, you learn about what's happening inside objects in the sky. Okay? And that is giving rise to what we now call as multi-Meissonier astronomy. So let's first see how is it that after looking at the sky, we learnt about some interesting nuclear properties. Some of them were also referred to by Sri Rubin in the morning. Sun is of course the major thing, all of us have to deal with it. In the sun, the standard wisdom is of course hydrogen combines to become helium. This doesn't happen in one go, it happens in many, many stages. And if you notice, in each of these stages, there are some neutrinos in most of them. Okay. These neutrinos have different energies. However, we can calculate what fraction of neutrinos come with which energies, and at least to some level, we know how many neutrinos should come from the sun. We should be able to detect the neutrinos, right? I mean, unless you detect them, we are not sure that we know how the sun shines. So since sun detects mainly electron neutrinos, we can build detectors on Earth to look at these neutrinos. Historically, there have been three main kind of detectors. One is detectors which are made up of chlorine. In fact, one of the first ones made by a person like Wilson had chlorine. This reaction, neutrino interact with chlorine, gives argon. And these argon nuclei are actually radioactive, and they actually were counted by Wilson, in fact, one by one about 50 years ago at Homestake, and that first showed that sun gives out neutrinos. Wilson was given Nobel Prize for that, I think in 2002 or 3, I'm not sure which year. Another nice nucleus, which the nuclear physicists have given us, is gallium, and neutrinos acting on gallium also give us germanium, another radioactive nucleus, which again can be detected through its radioactive decay, and you can count the number of nucleus. Third one that we just saw some time back was when an electron neutrino comes, hits an electron, that electron is moving with a very high speed, you can detect that at Super Kamiokande by using the photomultiplier vacuum. So things actually look pretty simple. Okay. This is the sun in neutrinos, sorry, the sun and in light. But of course, when you see the sun in light, you actually see only its surface. And the temperature of the surface of the sun is because of nuclear reactions which have happened millions of years ago. Because a photon producing nuclear reactions somewhere around there will take a long time to come out because it's going to scatter inside the sun. On the other hand, neutrinos, if they are produced in the center of the sun, actually come directly without interacting, and therefore when you observe the sun in neutrinos, we actually see neutrinos which are produced only 8 minutes ago, as opposed to the light which was due to reactions many, many minutes ago. This is the picture of the sun which is taken by the Super Kamiokande detector. This photo has an aperture time of about 1 by 1000th of a second. This has an aperture time of the order of 15 years. Okay, you really have to wait for a long time to be able to see that. It's also quite grainy, and this size is of the order of 30 degrees. Okay, so rather big. But once you see neutrinos, since we know how much light comes from the sun, we should know how many neutrinos should arrive. Okay, and that will ensure that tell us that we know how the sun shines. However, as you all know, this was not the case. If the expected number of neutrinos were like this yellow bar, actually observed ones at different detectors, chlorine, gallium and water, were corresponding to these blue bars. So it turns out that almost half the neutrinos happened to be lost, never to be found, and it was not dependent on energy. In fact, Super Kamiokande showed that on all energies, the survival of neutrinos was only about 50%. This was a puzzle that lasted for almost 4 decades, and there were big fights between astrophysicists, experimental physicists, detectors and theory physics people. The solution actually came from a breakthrough idea suggested by Mr. Brewer from Monte Carlo, who said that, see, all the neutrinos, all the experiments are looking for electron neutrinos, but it's quite possible that some of the neutrinos may be converted to other flavors of neutrinos. And since we don't look for the other flavors, we basically lose them. This is indeed possible using simple normal quantum mechanics, but only if the neutrinos have different masses and they mix. Now this statement looks actually very simple, but it was a very daring statement and it has a very important consequence. It means that electron neutrino, for example, does not have a fixed mass. What does that mean? That means that if by some mean you find a way to measure mass of electron neutrino, and if you take 10,000 electron neutrinos and measure their masses, you will get 3 different values. Okay, you will get answers of 5, 10 and 27. Okay, and randomly with certain probabilities. Okay, similarly with muon neutrinos, similarly with tau neutrinos. Indeed, if you want to talk about mixing of 2 neutrinos, this means that the electron neutrino, let's say which is blue, can have a mass which is nu 1, mass of this which is m 1 and mass of this which is m 2 with certain probabilities, but for a given neutrino you can never say what its mass is for a given electron neutrino. However, this leap of imagination actually helps solve the solar neutrino problem. It also involves something more interesting, which is what these three people pointed out, is that inside the sun, because neutrinos travel through matter, the neutrino flavor changes. Their mixing angle changes, their effective masses change, and crazy things happen. However, once you know what happens inside the sun, you can calculate this, and that's very, very important. The question now is, how can we check that this flavor change indeed is the cause of solar neutrino deficit? And the answer to that was given by an experiment called as SNO, or Sudbury Observatory, which use heavy water. Now what heavy water does is it has deuterium. A deuterium nucleus can have 3 kinds of reactions with electron neutrinos, with muon tau neutrinos, and this is what is called as a nuclear current interaction. These 3 neutrinos, these 3 reactions are sensitive to different combinations of electron neutrino and muon neutrino. Okay? And therefore, when you measure these 3 reactions, you will know exactly what fraction of electron neutrino and what fraction of muon or tau neutrino. Okay? This is the data from the experiment. These are those 3 reactions. 3 lines intersecting at a point is a confirmation that your theory is correct. You actually do that. This reaction, the blue one, is not affected by oscillations. And here, what you predict is actually what you observe, and that confirms that indeed neutrinos do oscillate to other planes. This is the last experiment, and the blue bar which is observed is equal to yellow bar which is expected. Okay, and that told us that all neutrinos from the sun are actually accounted for, and we understand the sun now. This is something which happened quite recently, 2002, compared to the thousands of years during which mankind has been observing the sun and speculating about exactly how it shines. Neutrinos come from cosmic rays, which is the first slide. Protons form a major part of cosmic rays. They come, interact with the atmosphere, produce pions, muons and so on, and many of these particles come down. Pions decay to give neutrinos, muons decay also to give neutrinos. Okay, these are the so-called cosmic ray neutrinos, the atmospheric neutrinos. These have been observed. In fact, among the first of them was observed in India, in Karnataka, in the polar gold fields in 1965. However, these ones also posed some problems. And the problem was that if you look at these 2 reactions closely, you will see that the number of muon neutrinos here is approximately twice of number of electron neutrinos. So there are details involved, but that's approximately correct. But the observed ratio was less than expected. In fact, it was almost equal to 1 and not 2. This was the so-called atmospheric neutrino problem, which again survived for almost 20 years. Till it was finally solved. It was solved by the same idea that Ponte Carlo gave, which is neutrinos may have mass and they may mix. Okay? If you do calculations using quantum mechanics, you see that the probability of survival depends on theta, which is the mixing angle, and a quantity called the delta m square, which is the difference in the squares of 2 masses. Okay, this part is very important. We will come to that in the next couple of slides. What that means is when neutrinos pass through the Earth, they may get converted to other kinds of neutrinos. So muon neutrinos produced can become a tau neutrino, for example. Okay, that's the kind of probability profile that you get. And indeed, in 1998, This is Takagi Kajita, who got Nobel Prize in 2015, declared on the behalf of Super Kamio Kande that this actually happens and therefore neutrinos do oscillate in atmospheric neutrinos. It was, I think, around the same time that I met Subir for the first time, and before this slide came, I never worked in neutrinos. So this is a slide, I always display this to say that this is a slide that changed my life and gave me the direction of research to go to, because so I had refused to work on neutrinos, saying that I don't believe neutrinos have mass. And Alexis Milnov, whose photo you saw some time back, had gone for this meeting. The next day he came back from the meeting and gave me this slide. Okay, so that's the time when I started working in neutrinos. So that's now we know that neutrinos producing reactors also oscillate, and indeed just about 5-6 years ago we have found that indeed they are also lost. But now we understand them. We know neutrinos mix, they have masses, and we are very comfortable with this phenomena. Although till now this happens to be the only phenomena which is confirmed, which is beyond the standard model of particle physics. We can also observe neutrinos produce in the Earth because of radioactivity, and we have also now recently been able to look at them and observe what they give. So now we know there are three neutrinos. Okay. These three neutrinos, electron, muon and tau, are distributed within the three different mass eigenstates which you see here. We have been able to measure this quantity, delta n square, which I mentioned some time back. However, what we have no idea about is whether the masses are arranged in this form or this form. This form, where this mass difference is much larger than this, is called as normal hierarchy or normal ordering. This is called an inverted order. Okay. We have no idea which of these is true. Since you only measure absolute neutrino masses, m1 square minus m2 square, we have no idea where is the zero of neutrino masses. We don't know absolute neutrino masses. On this scale, they may be here, they may be here, the lowest one, the zero may be here, here, or maybe somewhere way, way, way down there. We don't know if there are more than three neutrinos. We don't know if there is CP violation in the lepton sector. We know that there is CP violation in quark sector. As Shirup said, it was observed all the way back in 64. We have not been able to observe it in neutrinos, but again simply because they are very, very difficult to detect. They can there be also their own antiparticles, and again search for that is all. There are experiments addressing all of these questions. In fact, we need bigger detectors, much bigger than Super Kamio Kande. These are, of course, they are not under consideration. However, the detectors can be of the kind of Megaton Motor-Cherenkov. There is a bigger brother of Super Kamio Kande or Hyper Kamio Kande, which will come up in Japan, and instead of it will be about 20 times heavier than Super Kamio Kande. People are thinking of building detectors which are made up of scintillators. 50 is now looks very ambitious, but of the order of tens of kilotons, and there have been attempts to have 100 kiloton liquid argon detectors. However, although 100 won't happen, perhaps in about 30 will actually happen, and it might happen in the experiment that you see down there. This is an experiment called as DUNE, or Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment, where fermilab produces neutrinos and they are passed through the Earth about 1600 kilometers to this underground laboratory where you can actually detect. This is IceCube. The largest detector which exists currently. Details I will leave to Subir. Just I will show you that this is Eiffel Tower as compared to the size of Ice Cube. This is exactly the South Pole, and it has 10 to the power 12 liters of ice. And that's the volume. That just to make you aware that this is really, really big. We are trying to build a detector called India-based Neutrino Observatory, or INO. Somewhere near Tamil Nadu. It is getting delayed because of various other considerations, but technically speaking we are ready to build it. The major thing about the detector is that it is made up of magnetized iron, about 50 kilotons of that, which is going to be the largest electromagnet ever built in the world. Because it is magnetized, it can distinguish neutrinos from antineutrinos, because neutrinos produce negatively charged particles. Antineutrinos will produce positive charged particles. Of course, magnetic field can separate them, and therefore they can determine the mass ordering of neutrinos. So therefore, looking at what happens to neutrinos coming from the sky, we can indeed observe properties of neutrinos. But this is a conference on something fundamental, and that's a major question. How do neutrinos get their mass at all? This is something for which experiment perhaps will not suffice. The problem, as we pointed out today morning, is the standard model of particle physics. Mass is given because of interaction between Higgs, a left-handed fermion, and right-handed fermion. For the neutrinos, we don't have right-handed neutrino, so we have no clue how to give it mass by the Higgs mechanism. We of course have other ways of doing that, but all of them come under physics beyond standard model. Okay. So definitely with something beyond that. Some of the group of possibilities that is very popular among physicists is the so-called seesaw mechanism, about which we spoke today morning, but I will not go into details on that. What I will go to is the other way around. Now that we understand something about neutrinos, how can we use that information to use neutrino observations to look at what is there in the sky? So neutrinos come from the sky at all energies, right here from micro electron volts to maybe even 10 to the power 18 electron volts. So we have a very large spectrum, similar to the spectrum we have for light, right? We have all the way from radio waves to the gamma rays, and we have a similar spectrum for neutrinos, with neutrinos here coming from the Big Bang or cosmological, from the sun, from supernovae, from atmosphere, and here are the ones which come from astrophysical sources, which again I leave for Subhij to speak. They are nice because they don't bend in magnetic field, so they come straight. They are also nice because they can come from regions from which light cannot come. For example, from inside stars or from the centers of active galactic nuclei. So I talk about two main kinds of these neutrinos. One of them will be cosmological neutrinos, which are energies less than milli electron. These are the ones that form the cosmic microwave, cosmic neutrino background. Okay, there are about 110 per neutrino per flavor, therefore 330 per cc in all, as I spoke before. The temperature is also known, about 0.7 milli electron volt energy, or about 2 Kelvin as compared to 3 Kelvin of photons. There is a limit on effective number of neutrino flavors, but it will not go into that. But they contribute to dark matter energy density, depending on the mass of neutrino, this is how much they will contribute. So the mass of neutrino is 1 electron volt, they will contribute to about 0.5 times the density of the ions. Okay, so clearly not much, although technically they still qualify. What's more important is that they allow us to look very, very long back. The CMB photons started when the universe was about 400,000 years old. Temperature was about 0.2 electron volts and redshift was 1100. Relic neutrinos started when they were 0.8 seconds, universe was 0.8 seconds, 1.8 seconds old. So we really, really can go back all the way to almost 0.2 seconds after Big Bang, and basically redshift of the order of 10 to the power 10. Detecting them is very, very hard because energy is milli electron volts, and nothing that we know can be triggered by a milli electron volt neutrino. Okay. There are ways that people have proposed which actually use torsion balances. However, let me not go into detail, but just mention to you that given the current Q values of torsion balances, we are about 10 to the power 10 away from what we have currently. Therefore, this idea is almost impractical. However, I guess audience perhaps has some people who have done torsion balances, so that's just something to start discussions about. A nice thing that people think would actually work is induced inverse beta decay reaction. So for this, what you do is you look at a nucleus that undergoes beta decay. So N1 normally undergoes N2 plus electron plus antineutron. This reaction can be induced by a very low energy electron neutrino, okay, and as a result, the energy of this electron would be slightly more, so few milli electron volts more than the final endpoint energy. Okay, so to detect that, you need a background free environment and energy resolution of the order of milli electron volts. Very difficult, futuristic, but in principle, it's possible. And in fact, people are trying, I think experiment called Mare has been suggested, and there's also a Triton experiment that tries to do that. I will then come to neutrinos coming from a core collapse supernova. Nice thing about this, so this is one phenomenon in which all the four fundamental forces act one after the other. So first, gravitational force. This is a star which is maybe of the order of 10 times the mass of the sun. Outside layer is hydrogen, inside helium, inside oxygen, silicon, and the core is the core of iron. Okay. Now of course, beyond iron, there are no nuclear reactions that can be sustained. So the iron core remains iron core. Its size increases and it crosses the Chandrasekhar limit. It means that now the core has to collapse. It can't go much bigger than that. So now the gravity's role is collapsing this core from the size of about maybe a few hundred thousands of kilometers to the size of 10 kilometers, very fast, within of the order of much smaller than a second. This core, when it collapses, the density increases exponentially. It can even cross the nuclear density, almost 10 power 15 grams per cc. And that means that nuclear forces now come into play, and that causes a shock bounce. Okay. You may know that nuclear forces at very small distances are repulsive. Okay. And that repulsion will cause a shock wave that starts traveling outwards. That's the role of strong nuclear force. So strong nuclear force is trying to push the envelope out. But remember, this was the core. The star is some 10 solar masses, it's falling inside. There's a competition between these two, and not 10 solar masses normally wins over 1.4 solar masses. Okay? So 1.4 solar masses need some help. That is provided by neutrinos, which are now trying to push out. And indeed, it is observed that they give, or they may give sufficient push to be able to cause some instability, which will now grow, and then hydrodynamics takes over, which is electromagnetism, and finally star explosion. Neutrinos that come out of this process is really large. 10 power 58 neutrinos come out within 10 seconds. More than 99% of energy of this collapse actually comes out as neutrinos, because nothing else can come out. Everything else is trapped. Okay. They come out in three phases. First, only electron neutrinos, and then in these two phases, neutrino species of other possible flavors. For neutrino oscillations, this happens to be a very important thing. Okay. And the reason is that inside this core now, the neutrino density is so high that we have neutrino-neutrino interactions in addition to neutrino with matter interactions. When such things happen, your equations of motion become non-linear. And as you know, when things become non-linear, they become almost unsolvable. Okay. So in fact, this problem was realized in 2005. And I have been working on this for the last 15 years almost, and we do not have a complete solution. Okay, we have solved a problem in some small domains, but not everything. So it's still an unsolved problem, mainly because of the non-linear interaction that happens inside this. Okay, but of course, even when neutrinos pass through this, there are interesting phenomena that end up happening. Recent excitement, this is really new, last 1 or 2 years, is the following. So remember, the main problem is neutrinos giving sufficient push to explode the star. Okay, people do simulations on supercomputers, trying to put more and more physics in, making it more and more realistic. They are able to explode stars with smaller masses, may up to 10 solar masses. Beyond that, it becomes difficult. Question is, can neutrino force be enhanced so that they give more push to the shock wave that's coming out? This can happen because of neutrino oscillations. So what happens is the following. Electron neutrinos come out, muon neutrinos are coming out. Muon neutrinos happen to have larger energy than electron neutrinos. Okay. However, they have smaller number. Okay. Also, electron neutrinos have more cross section than muon neutrinos. What you would prefer is larger cross section and higher energy, so that the flux is larger. This can happen if the neutrino flavors interchange. So the electron neutrinos get energies of muon neutrinos, and when they come out, they have larger cross section. Okay. So neutrino oscillations, if they happen deeper inside the star, can actually push the shock wave faster. And what has been found by people, including myself, in the last few years is the following. In 2008, when I came to Shubhir in Oxford, we knew this. We have figured out that these non-linear effects can start collective oscillations at 100 kilometers. However, what we have figured out about 2 years ago is that if there are angular anisotropies, oscillations can start even at 10 kilometers from the center. Okay. And we are hoping that this is, which is quite naturally possible, could solve the problem of supernova explosions using neutrinos. We have observed neutrinos coming from supernovae only once in 1987, and these are the counts that you see, a very small number of the order of 20 or so. It confirmed that supernovas pull from neutrinos, but the number of events are very small, so we could not do any more things except maybe some new physics models. But now we have supernova detectors all over the Earth. Some of them can actually see the supercomputer can see 10 to the power 4 neutrinos. Hypercomputer can see 10 to the power 5 neutrinos. Ice cube, in a very strange way, can actually be sensitive to neutrino flux and can see 10 to the power 6 neutrinos. Once we see it, first thing that happens is we identify a neutrino mass ordering within 10 seconds. Planned experiments take about 10 years to do that. We observe this in 10 seconds and we can locate the supernova about a day before it is seen in the sky. Because neutrinos start from the supernova when the core collapses, light starts when the star explodes. There's a gap of about 1 day between these two phenomena. So once we see neutrinos, we know that tomorrow supernova will explode. We can identify the location in the sky within about 5 degrees or so, which means the optical telescopes can actually point there. There is something called an SNews, and right now I have put my phone on silent, but if that would explode it now, a message SMS will suddenly come and ping. Okay. Can observe many other things like tracking of shockwave inside the star, which you cannot do with light, and see many exotic things like QCD phase transitions. Astrophysical neutrinos, I am going to leave it all the way for Subir to talk about. Yeah, I mentioned last thing, which is it would have been nice if even Tarun was here. In addition to light, in which we have been observing the sky so far, now we have neutrinos. These are actually high energy neutrinos detected by IceCube. Now we have gravitational waves, and astronomy has really become multi messenger. This was an example. Are you going to mention this? If not, I'll. There was a blazar observed at there was a high energy neutrino observed at IceCube in 2017 September. Signal went to all the telescopes, and indeed it was observed immediately by some X-ray telescopes, some of the satellites which are meant to detect gamma rays and so on. In fact, all of these dots that you see here are either satellites in the sky or ground-based stations which were able to confirm this neutrino now in light, in X-ray, gamma ray and so on. So this is the developed multi-messenger astronomy. I'm going to leave you with this signal. Neutrinos offer you a new window to the universe, just like gravitational waves did in today's first talk, as Tarun said. We can look at extremely small scales, where we can identify mechanisms for neutrino masses and mixing. We can look at extremely large scales, like astrophysical sources or cosmology. And of course, we also have speculative applications, because everybody asks, what are they good for? They are indeed good for certain things, as you will see listed here. So I'll stop here. We can discuss them more if time permits afterwards. So,
yeah. Thanks for the very clear and comprehensive talk. So I gave him extra 5 minutes, so he will give me 5 minutes. So I'll give him 5 minutes. Time for questions. Yes, please.
Right. You need a.
Yes.
1987. Mm-hmm. Much talk that there was a superluminous neutrinos which reached the Earth before the main planet. And after that, died down. What is the status?
Well, that is still dead, in the sense that the actual actual timing of these neutrinos which are supposed to have come is not clear. The clock would have been off by a certain time, and that would be the simplest explanation, and therefore people haven't pursued that. That is my understanding.
So, maybe Kande was designed to measure proton decay, and they didn't care too much exactly what time the proton decay. So their clock had not been synchronized with the atomic time clock. But if you consider that another experiment, IMD, also detected neutrinos, so if the first event in Kamiokande is assumed to have arrived at the same time as the first event in IMD, I think at a clock, then there is no room for supernova. Just as well. Okay, that's one.
That I leave for Subir. He's going to talk about ice cube.
Just to come and talk about open balances. When in 1980, Rama Sorsi proposed open balance experiments at the ASD. One of the primary experts to detect relic neutrons. His idea was to have a large superconducting total balance and all that. But along with that, what he thought, he will load one side of the proton balance with propellers of the size, some heavy.
About one, this is indeed the one that I found, 1.5 centimeter pellets.
And he wanted to match the degree of interference with the 1980, that was the proposal. Of course, in those days, funding agencies never gave so much money, maybe money.
Yeah.
So we have to finally set it for it.
See, indeed the same thing. The De Broglie wavelength of 1.5 millimeters, and you put neutrino targets of this size in half of this.
Yeah, it's calculated for 60 microns or something.
There's one here.
Put it on.
You were talking that neutrinos change flavors. So is there any specific mechanism through which they change flavors?
See, in mechanism for changing of flavors.
Okay.
See, there is actually nothing special. Okay. In quantum mechanics, suppose you have a multi-level system, say two-level system, and your initial state is not an eigen state of energy. We'll observe that after some time, it's possible for the initial state to go into the other state. Okay, so you don't need any special mechanism. That's the beauty of this mechanism. Just the fact that your initial state, which is a flavor state, is not an energy eigen state, enough to cause these neutrino oscillations. By the way, this is a quantum mechanical phenomenon, oscillations, which we can observe at a distance of 10 power 13 centimeters, right from the sun to the earth. So this shows you that quantum mechanics is not always a small scale phenomenon. This can happen over very, very large distances.
Sir, another question is it possible to detect neutrinos if we accelerate the products of beta decays?
If we accelerate the products of
beta decays.
Okay. So, see, beta decay products are new nucleus, daughter nucleus, and electron. Okay. At the time the beta decay has occurred, the neutrinos have already escaped. Okay. So, there is no point in accelerating the products again.
Sir, you talked about the neutrino push up to the supernova. So, if before we can detect it before the supernova explosion, we can detect it. So, how do we? Is there so from atmosphere also we get many neutrino oscillations, and from these sources also we get. Is there any separate signature telling science that it says that there is a difference between that and this?
Okay. So, normally you detect neutrinos by using the energy. Okay. In the supernova case in particular, okay, let's say supernova happens in our galaxy. Our Supori Kamiokande is going to detect about 5000 neutrinos in 10 seconds. Now, if you look at atmospheric neutrinos, it sees about 5 to 10 per day. Okay, so background to the neutrinos from a supernova, because of atmospheric neutrinos, is going to be very, very small. On top of that, you can distinguish them by the energies, because the supernova gives mega electron volt neutrinos. Atmospheric neutrinos are giga electron volts.
So it is, if at all the supernova is in our galaxy, this is the case. If it is far away, then it will take longer time, and the energy will be, we can scale it down to our atmosphere, then we can't differentiate, right?
So what we lose is not energy, because neutrinos just come without losing energy. What we lose is flux. So if the supernova happens, let's say in a nearby galaxy, then in super Kamehameha, you may not even see it, because there could be hardly maybe a few events that may happen, and they may be actually getting lost in the solar neutrino. So it is very, very hard to find neutrinos from nearby galaxies in super Kamehameha, but you know, there is always Ice Cube, Ice Cube Gen 2, which can do that. You need a very large detector.
Another question. Let's make it quick, because I think you are running out of time.
The detection itself of the neutrons is very difficult. Since the detection of neutrons itself is difficult, so how serious are you about the application? How serious are you about its practical applications in the last slide?
The first one is getting built as we speak. Okay? Non-proliferation. It is being done as we speak. Okay? If people want strategic importance thing, this is done. Earth tomography, to some extent, Ice Cube has done. These are slightly more speculative, but you know, there are decades in front of us. Okay, so all that I have written here is not completely speculative. Some of them we have done to some extent.
He wants to know if you have a mobile phone
with neutrinos. I can tell you the maybe let's go to next question. But I can tell you a way to make money using neutrinos, right? So okay, after all questions are over, I can tell you how to make money. But if everybody knows, then nobody makes money. Sorry.
Last question here, please.
Sir, you have Shiv asked about flavor. Like, is there any separate mechanism? You have said that we can't. Can you repeat it again? That we can't find any energy eigenstate. So
let's say you have multi-level system. Take yes. A simple two-level system. Okay, it has two eigenvalues. Okay, if your initial state is not any one of these eigenvalues, it's a linear combination of the two. That is your initial state. Then, as time progresses, this state will change and go to another state.
Sir, so it may happen that suppose it goes to the another state, that other state is nothing but a unitary transform of the first state. The other state that it may go to may be the unitary transform of the first state.
No, it's not. Normally, if you have a multi-state system, yes. The other state is normally, in simple case, orthogonal to the first state. Indeed. Okay, so you can go to a state which is orthogonal to that by this transformation.
Okay, that was very interesting. We can continue the discussion. Is that tea now? Yeah. So let's now break for tea, but first let's thank Norman for a very interesting talk.